The Financial Survival Network, helping you survive and thrive in the new economy. Go to carrielutz.com and sign up for 30 free micro trainings on financial survival.
This show is brought to you by Miles Franklin. They've been selling gold and silver for 22 years, and I'm a customer because when you buy, they ship. For more information, go to milesfranklin.com or call them at 800-822-8080.
$14.90 WGCH. This is Carrie Lutz. You're listening to the Financial Survival Network. And nationalizations seem to have become the theme of the day. And with us to explore it, Ranting Andy Hoffman for our Monday get-together. Andy, how you doing?
I'm doing fantastic, Carrie. How about you?
I'm doing good. Doing good. I mean, I'm watching gold and silver prices kind of like a little ping pong ball on a small table with a couple of professional Chinese ping pong players whacking that ball back and forth, but nobody misses. But I can see that the miss is coming. And who knows, maybe this nationalization in Argentina is the beginning. What do you think?
Yeah, well, if this is a ping pong table, that's a loaded ping pong ball because they're there's nothing equitable about what we're seeing in the markets today. In fact, before I get to Argentina, just to note what we've seen in the last week or so with gold and silver is and the stock market combined is things I've never seen before. The level of control at the exact same times of day every day. And, you know, we had a big surge on Tuesday with the in gold with the Dow down 200 points, which kind of broke cartel rule number one of never letting gold be seen as a safe haven. So they quickly, moved to eliminate that day. And then Thursday we had a surge and they quickly attacked to try to get rid of that day. And as you could see this morning, the shares are once again under attack, even though silver's up 7 cents. But what you're talking about with nationalization is I'm writing a piece right now about it. We had a major, major news event, and in any kind of free market, this would have reverberations throughout the entire world, and that's that the Argentinian government has nationalized YPF Repsol, which is the largest oil company in Argentina, and just that joint venture is the third largest company in Spain, and they just took it with no warning. Basically, I think you're probably going to lose all your money if you own that stock, which is a big cap oil stock. And this is exactly what I've been talking about is going to happen in the mining sector down the road.
And a note on Argentina, they nationalized all the pension funds in the country like 2-3 years ago, and they're going to nationalize everything. And probably you're going to see a number of other countries doing similar things. I mean, you've seen it in Venezuela. This is a trend, and your fear of them nationalizing mining companies in the U.S. as well as in other places, realistic. I mean, they're basically the mining companies in China are nationalized. They have to sell all their production to China.
Yeah, and the rule here, it isn't even just a mining thing. The rule here is that when bad economic times come, you see socialism. And again, this isn't about Obama or Bush or any of these guys. It's about the decline of the United States. And as a result, there's more and more poor people. They're on food stamps. They need printed money everywhere to help them stay alive. And as a result, the government starts to take over everything in sight. And mining companies, oil companies, our healthcare, you name it, everything is going to be taken by the governments. And frankly, they may even take over the banks and brokerages. In some ways, they have already. So if you're in the system with assets that can be taken by the government, which is essentially everything, except for things like physical gold and silver, you're at risk for this very, very event that we saw today with YPF Repsol.
Yeah, and let's not forget about the discussions in Congress to effectively nationalize IRAs, 401ks, KIOs, private pension plans, and basically swap them for safe government securities.
Yeah, I mean, look at France, for instance, right? France has got the same horrible economic problems as everyone else in Europe. And they're facing elections in next week. I think they have two runoffs. I think there's one and then there's another. But the fact is, you know, you have Sarkozy, who's considered a blittering idiot. And, you know, he's as conservative about finance as George Bush was. Just he's printing money left and right.
Yeah.
But the fact is, the people don't want any of it. The country is in dire economic shape. They have no interest in bailing out some of these other pigs, even though they're a pig themselves. And therefore, Sarkozy is going to probably lose to either the liberal candidate Holland or the ultra-liberal candidate. I think the person's name is Mershon or something like that. And those kind of people are going to nationalize everything and do exactly what Argentina's doing. And it's going to go right up the line from Greece to Portugal to France, Argentina, and eventually to the country that loses the world's reserve currency.
Yeah, there's no sure prescription for sending a country into a massive depression than to nationalize the major industries. It's guaranteed, works every time, because once the profit motive, what's left of it, is obliterated, then these companies run for socialistic reasons. They're basically become a government program for putting people on payrolls, getting rid of unemployment, doing social, socialistic programs that eventually destroy the underpinnings of the economic system. It's happened in California. This was the given. They'll wind up cutting the work week in France from 35 hours to 30, to eventually you'll be a part-time worker getting paid full-time. That's the way it works with socialism. And once you start, it's pretty hard to stop it.
Well, my piece today, which will be out in a few hours, it's called Gerald Celente Patriot. Because I just read his latest Trends Journal, which came out this weekend, just a fabulous synopsis of the underpinnings of the United States attitude toward the rest of the world. And one of his famous sayings is when the money stops flowing down to the man in the street, the blood flows in the street. And that's exactly what the problem is here. Because we have so much poverty and unemployment, and inflation that people can't afford life, the government has to take things over and create a military state to avoid the mass social unrest. And that's what all these nationalizations are about. It's not helping the country in the big picture, but if you're a government official, that's the only thing that you know to do. Just like the only thing Bernanke knows to do is print money. The only thing a leader of a country in such dire financial straits knows to do is to take everything over and put the army in charge with guns. It never works. Always the system that when they try to do it, it ends with revolt and a rebooting of the system. But that's what they're going to do around the world.
No question about it. And it's kind of like if you go to a brain surgeon, you're going to get brain surgery. If you go to a bankruptcy lawyer, you're going to be going bankrupt. And if you go to government, you're going to get socialism. The two just go hand in hand. There's really no avoiding it.
Yeah, the only way to avoid it is to have a gold standard in the first place, because you can never create the excesses that have to be unwound. I mean, there's no better way of describing a fiat currency system than a Ponzi scheme. And I don't say that lightly. It really defines what a Ponzi scheme is. The only way it can continue is through confidence and increased size. And eventually, the ramifications of that increased size are that confidence gets broken. So it will happen. And therefore, you're going to see the historical pattern we're talking about of nationalization, socialization, and all the evils that come along with the end of a fiat currency system.
Yep, I'm afraid you're correct. And I'm afraid that, as the man said, the only thing we learn from history is that we don't learn from history. It's all been done before. It's all going to get socialized. Then it will dawn on humanity at one time that, hey, maybe this socialism stuff isn't so good. Then they go about breaking it up, and then the cycle starts again. So on that lovely note, well, at least gold and silver are still at reasonable levels, and at least you can get it at Miles Franklin for now, right?
Absolutely, and I believe that these huge chart patterns that are now 7 or 8 months in size, These reverse head and shoulders, I think they're the direct result of 7 months of suppression. And between the fundamentals and the technicals here and what I see coming for Europe in the next few months, it's just hard to believe that people would not take a serious look at converting some of their paper dollars into real physical assets right now.
Well, there's still time, but for how much longer, that remains to be seen. Anyway, Andy, thanks for being on again, and we will talk to you next week and watch the soap opera continue.
I look forward to it.
All right. Be well.